So to successfully manage a patient who's in cardiac arrest, the caregiver must carefully, systematically, and immediately identify the cardiac rhythm and choose the appropriate and most effective treatment algorithm. In this section, we'll be discussing the different cardiac dysrhythmias that lead to cardiac arrest, their characteristics, and the appropriate therapies to treat and correct the particular dysrhythmia, if at all possible. The patient's past medical history and any or all events leading up to that medical emergency will help the healthcare professional determine if there's any chance of reversing an underlying cause for the cardiac arrest. An example of this is assessing the patient with the 5 H's and 5 T's, which are going to be discussed in detail in the ACLS secondary survey section of this program. It's important to remember that until the underlying cause has been identified and corrected, pharmacological and electrical therapies may offer little or no help in attempt to resuscitate the cardiac arrest victim. Now, when assessing the electrical activity of a victim's heart, it'll be vital to recognize the underlying dysrhythmia and know how to treat it appropriately to restore a perfusing cardiac rhythm. A sinus rhythm is defined as any cardiac rhythm where depolarization of the cardiac muscle begins at the sinus node. It's characterized by the presence of correctly oriented P waves on the electrocardiogram. An ECG waveform represents each electrical event in the cardiac conduction system during a cardiac cycle. This doesn't mean necessarily that the muscle is reacting correctly or in correlation with the electrical patterns, but simply shows that the electrical events that may stimulate myocardial function are happening. This will be discussed in more detail when we look at each rhythm individually. Now, for the following explanation, we're going to be evaluating a normal waveform and assume that normal mechanical function is occurring. The P wave, which is the first waveform in the complete complex, is normally found upright in most leads. It represents the depolarization of both the right and the left atria, which occur at the same time. The segment between the P wave and the R wave represents the delay of the electrical circuit in the AV node. This is the time it takes from the end of the P wave to the beginning of the ventricular response, represented by the QRS complex. Now, the Q wave represents the first activity of the ventricular depolarization and is usually the first negative deflection after the P wave in the complete complex. We'll discuss the significance of Q wave formation specifically as it relates to certain dysrhythmias in each of the rhythm evaluations. Now, the R wave is the first positive deflection after the P wave and then is followed by the S wave, which is the first negative deflection after the R wave. The time frame between ventricular depolarization and repolarization is indicated via the ST segment. The ST segment is the baseline of the cardiac cycle and therefore is electrically neutral. There should be no inflection or deflection as it's isoelectric. ST elevation or depression of more than 1 millimeter can be clinically significant as it may indicate underlying cardiac issues both acutely and chronically. The T wave, which represents repolarization of the ventricles, should also be seen in the same general direction as the QRS segment. If there's an inversion of the T wave, this too can be indicative of a cardiac problem. I believe that it's very helpful to healthcare professionals to have a repeatable and easy way to interpret ECG rhythms, and therefore we're going to follow a serial pattern for reading and interpreting all ECGs. The pattern of interpretation most commonly used is to look at the following. The rhythm. Is the rhythm regular or irregular? Next, the rate. What is the rate? Is the rate normal, fast, or slow? Now remember, ECG paper grids are where time is measured along the horizontal axis, and each small square is 1 millimeter in length and represents 0.04 seconds. Each larger square is 5 millimeters in length and represents 0.2 seconds. So, a 6-second interval would be 30 large squares. To determine heart rate, count the number of QRS complexes over a 6-second interval. Multiply by 10. This method works well for both regular and irregular rhythms. Next, we look at the P wave. Are they present? Do they occur regularly? Is there one P wave for each QRS complex? Are the P waves smooth, rounded, and upright? Do all P waves have similar shapes? Next, the PR interval. Does the PR interval fall within the norm of 0.12 to 0.20 seconds? Is the PR interval constant? Then we look at the QRS complex. Is the QRS interval less than 0.12 seconds? Is the QRS wide or narrow? Are the QRS complexes similar in appearance? You see, in using a systematic approach to interpreting the ECG rhythms, we'll help ourselves and other ACLS teammates to efficiently, appropriately, and effectively diagnose underlying cardiac conditions.